Αρχίζει η πανηγυρική συνεδρία υποδοχής του ξένου εταίρου κυρίου Ζεράρ Μουρού στην Ακαδημία Αθηνών. Κυρίες και κύριοι υπουργοί, εκλεκτοί προσκεκλημένοι, κυρίες και κύριοι συνάδελφοι. Η Ακαδημία Αθηνών υποδέχεται σήμερα με ιδιαίτερη τιμή και ευχαρίστηση τον καθηγητή κύριο Ζεράρ Μουρού, κάτοχο βραβείου Νόμπελ Φυσικής έτους 2018, καθηγητή στο Οκολέζου της Εκόλ Πολυτεχνίκ της Γαλλίας και επίτιμο καθηγητή στο Πανεπιστήμιο του Μίσιγκαν, τον οποίον η Ολομέλεια της Ακαδημίας Αθηνών εξέλεξε το έτος 2020 ξένο εταίρο στον κλάδο των φυσικών επιστημών στην τάξη των θετικών επιστημών. Παρακαλώ τον Ακαδημαϊκό και Γενικό Γραμματέα της Ακαδημίας Αθηνών, τον καθηγητή κύριο Χρήστο Ζερεφό, να προσέλθει στο βήμα και να παρουσιάσει το έργο του νέου συναδέλφου. Παρακαλώ, κύριε Γενικέ.
Ευχαριστώ, κύριε Πρόεδρε. Εξοχότατη, εκλεκτή, προσκεκλημένοι κυρίες και κύριοι συνάδελφοι. The protocol is imposing the local language, Greek, but I take the liberty, Your Excellency Professor Gerard Mourou and Madame Mourou, to welcome you in this beautiful room, which, as Professor Mourou told us on his entrance, is the best place for his lecture, because it has Prometheus, the trilogy, very rare combination in painting art, and it refers to light. And Professor Mourou will speak about light, about his extreme light, about his ideas, and his ingenuity in inventing ways to increase the intensity of the light in such high energy light. Many things can happen. It's a different world which has been discovered by Professor Mourou. Βρισκόμαστε στην μεγάλη αίθουσα τελετών της Ακαδημίας Αθηνών κάτω από τις τοιχογραφίες της τριλογίας του Εσχύλου για τον Προμηθέα. Όπως ο Προμηθεύς έδωσε στην ανθρωπότητα την ενέργεια από τη φωτιά του άρματος του Απόλλωνα, όπως βλέπετε επάνω, έτσι και ο καθηγητής Γεράρ Μουρού, κατά αλληγορία, μας έφερε πολύ κοντά στο ακραίο φως που παράγεται με πειραματική μέθοδο που επινόησε ο ίδιος και την καθιέρωσε με τους συνεργάτες του. Η επιστημονική δραστηριότητα του καθηγητού Μουρού ξεκινάει από τη Γαλλία στη δεκαετία του 80, συνεχίζει και επαυξάνεται στο Μίσιγκαν, τον ΗΠΑ. Το 1985 ο Γεράρ Μουρού και η Ντόνα Στρίκλαντ, φοιτήτριά του, δημιούργησαν υπερβραχής και υψηλής έντασης παλμούς λέιζερ χωρίς να καταστρέπουν το υλικό του ενισχυτή για να πετύχουν αυτές τις υψηλές τιμές ενέργειας. Με ευφυή τρόπο πέτυχαν να δημιουργήσουν δραματική αύξηση της έντασης των παλμών του λέιζερ. Η ενίσχυση διαπλατισμένων παλμών βρήκε πολλές χρήσεις τόσο στην ιατρική όσο και στο περιβάλλον και τη βιομηχανία. Αυτή η πρωτοποριακή τεχνική χάρισε στον καθηγητή Μουρού και στην κυρία Στρίκλαντ το Νομπέλ Φυσικής το 2018. Ο καθηγητής Μουρού και η ομάδα του ήδη από το 1994 ανακάλυψαν τρόπους δημιουργίας μεγάλης έντασης ακτίνων λέιζερ εντάσσεων τεραβάτ, η οποία αύξησε και αυξάνει συνεχώς τις εφαρμογές αυτής της μεθόδου. Η μέθοδος ενίσχυσης παλμών μικρής χρονικής διάρκειας, για την οποία πήρε το Νομπέλ Φυσικής το 2018 ο καθηγητής μαζί με την κυρία, εμπίπτει ακριβώς σε αυτόν τον τομέα. Στα θέματα του περιβάλλοντος, οι πρόσφατες ιδέες του καθηγητή Μουρού σχετικά με τη διαχείριση πυρηνικών αποβλήτων μέσω της απενεργοποίησής τους μπορούν να οδηγήσουν σε καθαρή και ασφαλή πυρηνική ενέργεια, ιδίως στις εποχές που ζούμε, τις τόσο δύσκολες από πλευράς ενεργειακής, περιβαλλοντικής και οικονομικής. Επίσης, σπουδαία εφαρμογή από την εφεύρεση Μουρού είναι εκείνη στις εγχειρήσεις διαθλαστικής οφθαλμολογίας, στην οποία επιτυγχάνονται τομές που δεν θα μπορούσε κανείς να φανταστεί ότι θα μπορούσαν να είναι τόσο λεπτές και τόσο ακριβείς. Το ίδιο ισχύει και για τις εγχειρητικές παρεμβάσεις με λέιζερ σε διάφορους όγκους καρκινογενετικούς. Μια άλλη εξαιρετική εφαρμογή περιβαλλοντικού ενδιαφέροντος που χρησιμοποιεί υψηλής ισχύος λέιζερ είναι το LIDAR, Light Detection and Ranging. Η μέθοδος αυτή στηρίζεται στη διάδοση υπερστενών παλμών λέιζερ στην ατμόσφαιρα μέσω των φαινομένων νηματοποίησης. Επιτρέπει τη διάδοση παλμικής ακτινοβολίας λέιζερ τεράστιας ισχύος της τάξεως μερικών τεραβάτ σε αποστάσεις 1 έως 12 χιλιόμετρα μέσα στην ατμόσφαιρα χωρίς σημαντικές απώλειες ισχύος. Η τεχνική αυτή, ονομαζόμενη τεχνική ατμοσφαιρικής τηλεπισκόπησης, στηρίζεται στην τεχνική της αυτοκυματοδήγησης μέσω της δημιουργίας νηματίων διαμέτρου περίπου 100 μικρών του μέτρου. Η κυματοδήγηση αυτή, προερχόμενη από τη συνύπαρξη των φαινομένων της αυτοεστίασης, μη γραμμικό φαινόμενο CAIR και του φωτοϊονισμού δημιουργία πλάσματος στην ατμόσφαιρα, οδηγεί στη δημιουργία νηματίων λευκού φωτός στη φασματική περιοχή 150 νανομέτρων έως και 4,5 μικρομέτρων. Η ακτινοβολία αυτή διαδιδομένη στην ατμόσφαιρα προς ένα οπτικό δέκτη, αυτό στην πρώτη του εφαρμογή στη δεκαετία του 60 είχε ένα τηλεσκόπιο Κασεγκράν επίσης γαλλικής κατασκευής. Η τεχνική της ατμοσφαιρικής τηλεπισκόπησης FS LiDAR κατέστη δυνατή λόγω της υλοποίησης υπερστενών παλμών λέιζερ, ισχύως αυτών των μερικών τεραουάτς από τον καθηγητή Μουρού. Εκείνο το επίτευγμα που ο ίδιος προβάλλει κυρίως είναι οι ιατρικές εφαρμογές, ιδίως στη διαθλαστική χειρουργική των υψηλότατων εντάσεων ακτινοβολίας λέιζερ. Ο καθηγητής έχει συνεργαστεί με πολλές ερευνητικές ομάδες στην Ελλάδα, όπως στο ΙΤΕ και στο νέο ελληνικό μεσογειακό πανεπιστήμιο, ειδικότερα μέσω του προγράμματος ELI, Extreme Light Infrastructure. Το ELI είναι άμεσα συνδεδεμένο στην Ελλάδα με την εθνική ερευνητική υποδομή ELAS-CH, η οποία παρέχει τεχνογνωσία και υπηρεσίες τόσο στην ευρωπαϊκή υποδομή όσο και στην ελληνική επιστημονική κοινότητα. Μέρος του ELAS-CH είναι και οι εργασίες αποκατάστασης με λέιζερ των έργων πολιτιστικής κληρονομιάς, όπως του καθαρισμού της ρύπανσης στην επιφάνεια των μαρμάρων της Ακροπόλεως. Θα την είδατε όλοι πόσο ωραία λάμπει το πεντελικό μάρμαρο. Εκτός όμως από αυτά, ο καθηγητής Μούρου συνεργάζεται με Έλληνες συναδέλφους που μας τιμούν με την παρουσία τους. Σήμερα, τους καθηγητές Φωτάκη και Δημήτρη Χαραλαμπίδη, ο κύριος Φωτάκης από το ΙΤΕ, ο κύριος Χαραλαμπίδης από το Πανεπιστήμιο Κρήτης. Και στο σημείο αυτό θα ήθελα πριν ολοκληρώσω το λαουντάτιο της τελετής υποδοχής να τονίσω ότι με τη βοήθεια του καθηγητή Αλέξανδρου Παπαγιάννη από το Μετσόβιο Πολυτεχνείο αλλά και τη στενή συνεργασία του καθηγητή Δημητρίου Μπαλή και του Διευθυντή Ερευνών του Εθνικού Αστεροσκοπείου Αθηνών Βασίλη Αμυρίδη, η ομάδα, η δική μας Θεσσαλονίκη και η ομάδα του Μετσοβίου Πολυτεχνείου ανέπτυξε την τεχνολογία λέιζερ για μετρήσεις όζοντος και ορουμένων σωματιδίων στην ατμόσφαιρα ήδη από τις αρχές της δεκαετίας του 90. Είμαι πολύ υπερήφανος, κύριε Παπαγιάννη, γιατί διετέλεσα και εισηγητής στη διδακτορική σας διατριβή στο Πανεπιστήμιο των Παρισίων, Παρί 7. Ο καθηγητής Μουρού είναι μέλος του Haute Collège της École Polytechnique και διακεκριμένος καθηγητής στο Πανεπιστήμιο του Μίσιγκαν. Πριν πάω στην τελευταία παράγραφο, θα ήθελα να πω δύο λέξεις στα αγγλικά. Behind every successful man, there is always a wonderful woman. And Marcella, or Marcel in French, she has been in every picture that I saw from Gerard in the past. We are as closely in relation with my wife Effie, as you know. There's no picture of mine without Effie. And there's no picture of Gerard without Markel. So thank you, Marcel, for giving to humanity in such a good shape such a great man. Αγαπητέ Gérard Mourou. Dear Gérard Mourou, it's a great honor for the Academy of Athens to include you in the pantheon of fellows, and I will kindly ask the President of the Academy of Athens to decorate you with the necessary distinction badges and offer to you the diploma of the fellow. Just before you start, Mr. President, I wish to note that today coincides with the date of the inauguration of the Academy of Athens about 100 years ago. Thank you so much.
Τον λόγο έχει ο καθηγητής Gérard Mourou.
Monsieur le Président, Professeur Regalos, former President Christopher Forou, Professor Sinokatis, I'm sorry, you know, chers friends, chers Professor Zerfor, Kodamis, and so on. I'll really like to thank you very much to have given me the honor, really, to join this pantheon of scientists. And it's a great, really great honor to be inducted to this august institution founded by the first philosophers, Platon and Aristotle. And when I received the Nobel Prize, a few months after that, my friend Dimitri Karambidis invited me to Greece, and I gave a talk at this Museum of Acropolis, beautiful museum, Acropolis. And it's where I met for the first time, you know, Professor Christoph Zerefos, who had really the kindness to say if I wanted to join, you know, the Academy of Athens. And of course, you know, I accepted, you know, gladly this honor. And it's amazing because in this room, which is decorated by this beautiful painting, and this painting is about Prometheus. Prometheus who really stole the light to give it to God. And so this is very close, is very fitting to what I would like to discuss today, because my talk is going to be about what I call extreme light. So there's really a very incredible parallel between my work and this place. Perfect fitting. So I'm going to talk about this extreme light, always keeping in mind behind Prometheus. I hope I'm not going to finish like him. But anyways, something which is remarkably close to me. Okay. So let me talk to you about extreme light. And before we do that, I just want really to give a little bit of background. I had the privilege when the chairman of the Nobel Foundation called me the first Tuesday of October to tell me that I would get the Nobel Prize for the physics. I was, of course, you know, extremely ecstatic, you know, he said, but you know, there's more coming. And he told me that, in fact, I was going to share it with my former student, Donna Strickland. And so I was glad, of course, to get the Nobel Prize. It's something absolutely immense, I would say. But also the fact that I was really the teacher of the third woman Nobel Prize, Donna Strickland, was really something which was so nice, so important for me. And so this was very nice. I mean, Donna Strickland was the third woman to be have this privilege to be Nobel Prize. It's behind Marie Curie and Maya Goeppermeyer. So in the third one, it was in. So this is very nice, and I always like to start my talk by reminding you this story. So now you know that it's not exactly, the light doesn't really come exactly from Prometheus, but it started with the Big Bang. The Big Bang of 13.8 billion years ago. And but the light didn't come out immediately. It took something like 380,000 years for the light to become visible, because it had to go through this big plasma surrounding, of course, the Big Bang at that time. And now the light, you know, the first light, which is what we call incoherent light, incoherent because all the particles, all the photons, are completely different, one the other. It's like, you know, racers racing marathons, where they are all completely different from one another, and they are, you know, their outfit is different, and they don't know each other, and so you have women, you have men, and so on. I mean, it's a big mix. And so that's what we call, it's very analog to incoherent light. And the first coherent light came only 60 years ago. It is the first time, you know, that we were able really to produce coherent light. Now we are going to say, you know, what is coherent light? Well, coherent light, it's first demonstrated by Ted Mehmann, who was really the first one to produce a laser. And so the coherent light is very analogous now to an army marching, you know, and where all the militaries, you know, are dressed exactly the same, and from one. I'm sorry. Okay, these soldiers have to be. Thank you. Dressed the same, and they walk at the same pace, of course. And from when you see one soldier, you can determine the position of every other soldiers. I think it's a very good analogy, you know, between incoherent light and coherent light. And so, what is now amazing about this laser and this coherent light? This was, of course, a revolution, you know, in science, in physics. The fact that, just to give you an idea what you can do with light, you know, is you can take this coherent light and you can slow down atoms, for instance, almost to rest, okay? These atoms, you know, are really moving at hundreds of meters per second, and now with light, you can slow them down almost to a stop. And what is amazing is that you can also do basically the opposite. You can accelerate particles to enormous speed to very close to the speed of light. We cannot do better, but we can be very close to the speed of light. So it's amazing that with these lasers, with light, we can slow down particles, but also we can accelerate them to the speed of light. So you have this two big field, you know, the field of quantum light, quantum optics, you know, where you slow down the light to rest, and also what I called relativistic optics, where now particles can be moved by light to the speed of light, very close. And in order to do that, and I'm going to dwell mostly on the relativistic optics, because this is what I call now extreme light. What we, in order to do extreme light, what we do, we have to produce this extremely short pulse, okay? Pulses in a millionth of a billionth of a second, okay? And now, why do we want to do that? During this time, which is extremely short, the light propagates a distance which corresponds more or less to the size of a blood cell, okay? So it's very small. It takes about a second to go to the moon for the light, but in femtoseconds, the light just moves a distance close to the dimension of a cell. And so why do we do that? Why do we produce a very short pulse? This is really to produce, so we can produce extreme power. And this is very easy if with very, very short pulses, because the power is just energy divided by time. So even if small amount, if you are producing a small amount of energy, but if you can deliver it in this millions of a billionth of a second, the power that you are producing is in a petawatt range, 10 to the 15 watt range, which corresponds to 100 times the power of the electric grid, you know, in the world, the world electric grid. Okay, so this is phenomenal, of course. Okay, phenomenal. And now if you take this power, you know, which is the petawatt power, and you focus it to the dimensions of the wavelength of light, which is about micrometers, then you can produce, of course, an intensity which are immense. And with this intensity, you can produce pressure, light pressure. Light pressure in a regime of something like, which will correspond to about 10 million Eiffel Tower on the top of your finger. Immense, okay? So you see, with light, it's with light that we can produce the highest pressure. And you are going to see that it's also with light that we can produce the highest temperature and the highest accelerations, as you are going to see. So now that we can produce this very high intensity, now that we can produce this incredible pressure, we are going to change regime, okay? Until this extreme light, the laser with the lasers, and you know, we were studying only the electrons basically around the atoms, the nucleus of an atom. This, so we were doing what we call atomic physics. Now that we have this extreme light, we can shift from atomic to subatomic physics. And we come to completely different regime with completely novel applications I'm going to describe. So this is a little bit of chart showing the progress of intensities as a function of years since we, I'm looking for my pointers, you know. Since we, okay, I'm going to try to do, what's it called? Can I have a pointer? Okay. Thank you. Yeah. So, you know, in 1960, the laser was invented, and the intensity of the first lasers was not high. It was, of course, very, very high compared to common ordinary source, light source, but it was not high compared to what we have now. So very relatively short, low intensities. And then in few years, we were able really to increase the intensity to a level where we could really break down ionized gases and so on. This is about, and ionized also materials. And so, and this is, this about, we reach a level where we couldn't go higher. And the reason why we couldn't go higher is because we were breaking down the light. When the light was propagating inside the laser, we were breaking down the amplifiers and the optics, you know, what we were. So we had to stop at this level, at 10 to the 13. And then we came with this famous idea of CPA, a chirp pulse amplification, with my student again. and then, and with this technique, we were able to circumvent these problems of breaking down everything. Okay, we could circumvent, and I'm going to show you that how. And so we could go much, much higher with intensities, up to the point where we could now almost, we are at the point where we could almost materialize light and materialize vacuum, okay? So this is where we are now. We are not quite yet there, but this is what we are aiming at. But you see that as you are increasing these intensities, you go through different regimes in laser-matter interactions and different applications, okay? So this is what I'm going to talk about. As I said, I'm not going to talk. Yeah, and just a few seconds on Chirp pulse amplification. How do we really produce this magic? How we are able now to, you know, amplify light to enormous level? And I'm thinking now about Prometheus. You know, maybe he already invented Chirp pulse amplification. Maybe when he did what he did. So the concept works the following. We start with a very short pulse. The pulse is in a femtosecond regime, millions of a billionth of a second. And then we don't really take this pulse and try to amplify into this amplifier, because if we do that, then we are going to blow, we are going to break down the amplifier. So before we do that, we are going to stretch the pulse, to stretch it. We are going to stretch it by, say, a million times. If we stretch the pulse by a million times, we are going to decrease the pulse duration by a million times. And then you will be able now to amplify the pulse without destroying the amplifier. And once you have done this, then, you see, now you are going to do the converse of what you did before. You are going now to recompress the pulse. And you are going to have a giant pulse, which enormous pulse. Okay, so now I'm going to describe to you some of the applications, because now I know we are liberated. We have the basically the intensity we want, so we are going to do these incredible novel things with light. The first thing that we do, I mean, which was the most trivial one, is we are in this regime, okay, low intensity regime, we are going to do micro machining. And this is very, it's a very nice application where these times we were using, of course, the laser before to do machining, but they were long pulse laser. But if you are using long pulse laser, what you do is when you are heating the material that you want to ablate, for instance, well, to remove matter, you are going to heat relatively large volumes, and you are going really to create a mess, because you have this very, you eat these very large volumes. So you are going, say, for nanosecond, you know, we may say, okay, nanosecond is very short, but for us it's very long, in fact, you know, that's a billionth of a second. But then if you use a relatively long pulse, nanosecond, then you are producing machining, but not very nice. Now, if you are using femtosecond, 100 femtosecond, much, much shorter, then you are producing very clean hole, even ceramic, in anything. And also what is nice is you can focus the beam, you can cut the materials within the bulk of the target. Okay, and so you see now you will be able like to do things like cornea surgery. But if you assume that you have a cornea here, cornea is about a fraction of a millimeter in thickness. When you focus your beam, then you can really ablate material within the bulk. And if you are moving the target or moving your beam, then you can make the flaps, you know. And you can correct the visions of patients. And this is a very, very now big applications. Well, you can really correct your vision if you don't like to, if you cannot really, if you have to correct your vision and to avoid glasses. Now you can really correct the visions, and you see this, you have millions of people a year. Typically it's 2 million people a year with a procedure a year. 2 million people are getting this procedure a year. So it's very, very, it's amazing, yeah. So that's the first applications, okay? But this is not, this is at a relatively low intensity. Now as we increase, intensities, then you will be able to accelerate particles. You remember the pressure that we are able to create with the lasers. So now we are going to use this pressure to accelerate the particles in very close to the speed of light. And so again, so the energy of the particle would be very high. And this, by using very compact systems. So I'm going to describe some of the application right now. For example, this application I'm going to describe, but I had something on black hole, but I'm going to talk about it today. So we will have applications of medical, environment, spatial. So this is by using the accelerations of particles, okay? This very, 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 very efficient applications of acceleration of particles. So now the first thing that we did, of course, the acceleration of electrons. I cannot really talk about everything. So I'm likely to talk about only about the acceleration of protons, okay? Because you will see it's a lot and very, very important applications. So remember that to accelerate protons, and we likely to do it to the relativistic regimes, that the protons can reach, you know, GeV, giga electron volt regimes. You will see the applications. Here you see, for instance, we can do it in very simple manners. If we have a target here, we come with the lasers, and we are ionizing the materials, so we are separating the electrons and the protons, and so the electrons are pushed by the light, okay, and after that they attract the proton behind. So this way, it's a very simple, very simple way to produce protons in a relativistic regime. And I'm sure people, scientists in this audience, you know, who knows about that. It's we can accelerate protons over a fraction of a millimeter. We can take them to the relativistic regime. Extremely impressive. If you want
Really, if you want to produce GeV protons and you want to do it in a traditional way, this normally is what you need. Okay? Something which is in a range of about a kilometer. Okay? And of course, this kind of system, you can imagine the price, the cost of such a system. And so now we can replace this accelerator, but extremely compact accelerators. Okay, because it's not, we are going to now accelerate protons over a fraction of a millimeter instead of kilometers. Okay, so that gives you an idea, a sense of what we can do with extreme light. So now, applications, why did I, protons, basically relativistic protons, are very important for the medical, for instance. You have this famous application which is called proton therapy, okay, where take a protons, and instead of using X-ray therapy or electron therapy, the problem with those X-ray or proton therapy is the fact that if you have a tumor, this is for cancer, if you have a tumor which is lodged, you know, within the, some tissue, healthy tissues, then with electron or X-ray therapy, what you are going to do, you are going to burn the tumors, but also the tissues which are sitting in front of the tumor, which is, of course, not ideal. But with the proton, it's different. We can choose the energy of a proton, we can tune the energy of a proton, and then they can be focused on the tumors, and we can really can change the energy. We can burn only the tumors and not what's after the tumors and not what is before the tumors. So this is really, of course, the best way to do therapy. And fortunately, now the systems to produce protons are very expensive because they are big and expensive. So with laser, we should do the same thing, you know, and make a system, proton therapy system, very compact. And so less costly, less expensive. After that, there are other applications in the medical field, of course, where you can really make radionuclides, where also to produce, to treat cancers, and also for, can produce radioisotope also for diagnostics and so on. So having a compact, high energy source of particle is extremely important for medicine. Now there's also the other big applications. Trying to produce energy now, you know, energy in abundant amount of energy, but you want to produce abundant amount of energy in a safe and clean manner, okay? And of course, best way to, most abundant way to produce energy, I would say, you have to use nuclear energy, okay? We know that oil and all, you know, most of the oil or coal and so on, of course, produce all this bad carbon dioxide, you know, which give us, of course, this this climate change and so on. So we don't want to use that. So nuclear, of course, doesn't produce. We don't produce. we don't produce carbon dioxide. So this is really the method of choice. The problem is, of course, you know, we have this nuclear. We have this waste. It's nuclear waste that we need to deal with. So here and also, so I'm right now, and because there's some competent people here in the audience, I want really to discuss nuclear energy, production of nuclear energy, not by uraniums, as we do it now, okay, with fission, but by using thorium, okay, which is also another element, which had the advantage of being extremely abundant, or very abundant, and also leading to the waste, the nuclear waste that you can produce, is much less than with uranium, okay? And the lifetime, they don't last millions of years, okay? And so we have this incredible problem trying to bury all this nuclear waste, you know, and so that's difficult to do for a million years. Here we will have the lifetime, you are talking lifetime in a way, regime of hundreds of years, hundreds, which is relatively short, of course. So I have a short clip to show you.
Here is the Earth, our spacecraft, traveling for more than 4 billion years through space with 8 to 10 billion people on board. The total consumed power is of 100,000 power plants. Houston, we are running mostly on carbon energy that will be exhausted in a few hundred years. In addition, it creates a nefarious climate change and air pollution that will render in a few hundred years the Earth unlivable.
I think we have a solution. Our advice is to consider nuclear fuel. You have enough thorium on Earth for a few thousand years. Thorium used in an advanced driven system reactor, ADS, will produce only a small amount of short-lived nuclear waste.
Important application, of course, of extreme light, because with extreme light, again, I can produce neutrons, and this neutron can be used, you know, for nuclear energy. The other application, of course, of neutrons is related to do what we call transmutations. So you see, one thing happened is. When we are producing energy with what we are, you know, of course we are with fission nuclei, okay, uranium nuclei, or maybe here thorium nuclei, but this is uranium. And so when you take neutrons to fission these materials, and when you do that, what happens is, okay, you are breaking, you are really breaking the nuclei, and so you are producing your energy, but from time to time, you know, you don't break the nuclei. The nuclei is captured, by I'm sorry, the neutron is captured by its nuclei here, and so you know you have a new species, which is, for example, here Neptunium, and this is really a very dangerous one, and because its toxicity lasts for million years, okay? So of course it's something that you want to get rid of, and here again I want to use, I can use the neutrons really to transmute some of what we call minor actinide, that we can transmute them in species, you know, we split the, we fission these nuclei, and the fission products, you know, last only things like 11 minutes or peak seconds, okay, extremely short times. So this is one other applications of neutrons that we can produce with the laser. And now, and I'm going to stop at that point there. I'm just going to show very quickly also another big problem that we have, and we can be solution with extreme light, is the orbital debris. We know that since 1957, when the nuclear age started with Sputnik, not the nuclear, but the space age started with Sputnik, then we have created a huge number of debris. These debris typically moves in space at velocity which is about 10 times the velocity of the bullet, the fastest bullets, okay? So even if the debris is very, very small, at this speed, it can be very dangerous, very harmful. So here, just to give you an idea of the problem is, right now, we have about the equivalent of 4 Eiffel Towers, which was sent in space, okay, since the beginning space age. And now we have about half of an Eiffel Tower, which now circle in space around the Earth, we have, so you know, under the form of debris. Okay, so so the idea now, we can use the lasers. If we take high intensity lasers and we put it in space, or at least like something like a space station or so, and we try to monitor the sky, the space, and detect, you know, debris. When we see a debris, then we can aim the laser to the debris. And then we don't want really to blow the debris because it's very expensive in terms of energy. It takes a lot of energy. But what we want to do is just to create, to ablate the debris, you know, small amount of the debris, which is going to create a jet effect, a rocket effect, if you want. And this rocket effect is going to deorbit the debris, and it will, after sometimes, like can be days, can be years, but we don't care, it will go and fall out in the atmosphere and get burned. And so that is one of the big applications. I had a movie, but I'm not going to show it, about this, because I think we are running out of time. Anyway, the nice thing about when you get a Nobel Prize, you can really meet very important people, and like the Pope. And we had the pleasure with Donna to tell the Pope what we were doing for energy, you know, for space, and so on. So I guess I'm going to stop here by concluding, you know, in the spirit of the Nobel, in the spirit of Alfred Nobel, which really dedicated this prize for the greatest benefit of the humankind. I conclude that with the extreme light, you know, we are capable of enormous amount of things. We are capable of generating the largest field, the largest accelerations, the largest temperature, the largest pressure, and we can apply all these properties to a huge number of applications. So this light, you know, carries the best hope and opportunities for the future of science and society. And I'm going to stop at this point, and I would like to thank you very much for this invitation, as I said, to be part of your society here. Thank you very much.
Monsieur le professeur Mourou, nous vous remercions pour cet exposé vraiment fascinant, même à des non-spécialistes comme par exemple pour moi. Soyez le bienvenu au sein de l'Académie d'Athènes et nous vous souhaitons tout le succès à votre œuvre scientifique. Λύεται η συνεδρία. Ευχαριστούμε.